like the very blood within our life, within our spiritual life. So I started praying. And that day when the hurricane came up the coast, it got near the state line, my prayer was, oh Lord, go around, have the hurricane go around. I did this with my finger. Have it go around the Hampton Roads tide, that area, the tidewater area, and not affect this area. Millions of people had lived there, military, all kinds of folks, Virginia Beach, Norfolk, Hampton, all those areas. True story. I said, Lord, whatever your will, may it be done. But if I could make this small request, could you let it go around us and not affect this area? This is true. It came right up to Elizabeth City, edge of North Carolina, to the state line, and the storm went 150 miles around Richmond out into the ocean and went north. You know what my answer to the Lord was about Wichita Falls? When do you want me there? I'm standing here with a microphone today to ask you to think about what God wants to do in our country, what He's wanting to do in our community, what He wants to do in this church, His church. And I'd like to invite you to come help us worship today. We always have a music schedule that can be changed, songs can be dropped, everything can happen. But what's important, if we don't have the Spirit of God on our service, we do not have worship. Are you okay with that? Amen. So I'd like to invite two or three people, or whatever should come out, but I'd say two or three people who wouldn't mind to come out and pray for our country. And if you would, in a moment, just come and be seated on the pew and I'll know who you are. Then next to them, if you would like to come and pray for the community, the first two or three, come out and pray for the country. We have an incredible election coming up. It's absolutely, no matter who you vote for, you feel like you're doing the wrong thing. But God has a plan. What was your life like 11, 12 years ago? What was your life like even 20 years ago? And what is your life like today? Has God changed your life? My life is different than what it used to be. And today I know I'm still putting my hope and trust in Him more than ever before. So I'm asking two or three of you that won't mind to come up and just have a prayer, whatever God lays on your heart, just a brief prayer, to pray, to touch heaven, to pray for our country. If you'd like to pray for our country, I'd like to invite you to come and just sit over here by Stephen, even now. Just go ahead and feel free to do that. Secondly, if you would come and pray for our community, the people around this area, the state of Florida, the city of Tallahassee, Leon County. If you'd like to come and pray for that, I'd ask that you pray in the next one in order, whatever that may be, and just use that in your prayer. And lastly, if you'd like to come and pray specifically for this church, I'd ask that in your prayer for the country, you pray for the country, not the church, not the community, but you pray for the country. And in the community, you pray for the community. Not necessarily the country, although it's a part of that, not necessarily part of the church, but just for the community. And for the church, if you pray specifically for the church, not just the country or the community, but for the church. And if you'd like to do that, I invite you to come and be a part of this now. I hope that we have three or four more people who come and pray. Because I really believe this. I believe with all my heart. Prayer is what touches the heart of God. And give Him glory, give Him praise. And then when the last person prays, I'll come up, and then we'll receive that morning's tithes and offerings and have our ushers to help or whatever it may be. I just want you to realize this. The whole month of October, God has laid on my heart about having a month of miracles. A month of miracles. I still believe in miracles. Do you believe in miracles? Do you believe God can do anything but fail? And today I want to share with you in the message in just a bit that there were some miracles that Jesus wanted to do, but He couldn't because of the people's unbelief. The people said they believed in Him. There were people on the day when He rode into Jerusalem. They're shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is He who comes in the name of the Lord. And a week later, those same people, some of them were going, crucify Him, crucify Him. I pray that if you and I will be the committed Christian that God has called us to be, we'll keep praising Him, we'll keep honoring Him, we'll keep glorifying the Lord our God. Amen? Amen. Today, let's pray for our country. And while the music's playing and these come lead us, pray with them as they pray for the country, as they pray for the community, as they pray for the church. Amen? God bless you. Come lead us today. Just bow with us.
God, I pray for our country. Many of those who founded it.
Yes, Lord.
Founded it.
Always pray. Oh, thank you, Lord.
We don't follow you, God. As a country, our leadership doesn't believe in you. But you tell us to pray for those who need us.
Yes, Lord.
So, Lord, for those we have elected already,
yes.
I pray that you give them wisdom.
Yes.
I pray you convict them, Lord. I pray that you have them put their trust in
yes,
you.
Lord. For our country. For this country.
Not in our military strength,
yes.
Though it is great. Not in our economy, though it is the greatest in the world.
Yes.
Not in our intellect, though we are some of the most brilliant people around. Lord,
yes.
I pray that we put our trust in you.
Amen.
Because,
amen.
Lord,
thank
we
you.
Need to be humbled.
Yes.
We need to come to you.
Amen.
Lord, for those who are electing,
yes.
Give the country wisdom.
Give us your foundation, Lord.
Lord, let us trust in you, because as it seems, those who might win appear not to. So, Lord, let us pray for them, regardless of if we like them, regardless of if the election goes as we want, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Let us as a country
pray
for them
you.
To do your will.
Yes, Lord.
And, Lord, no matter what happens, that your will be done.
Amen.
Not ours,
let
not mine,
to you,
but let your will be done in our country, Lord.
Yes, Lord. Thank
because
you.
Because we need you.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen. 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 Thank you.
Oh, Father, we thank you for your many blessings.
Yes.
And
thank you, Father.
For the founders of this nation who have led this country on Christian principles. Father, we know that we have strayed away from your principles and your decrees. We know we are not going in the right direction.
Thank you,
but Father, we pray for the leaders that you will turn their heart to you.
Thank you, God. Amen.
Father, we pray that this election, you will guide us to do what is best for this country. Father, let us not put our trust in the leaders. Let us not put our trust in our economy, or wealth, or the military power, or whatever it is. But let us return to you. If the nation will humble, the people in the nation will humble themselves and turn to your face,
amen.
Pray that you will hear our prayers,
amen.
And change our hearts, and lead us in the direction that we should go. Let this country be a light to the world.
Yes,
that it will uplift Christ so that many will see what is happening here to follow you. Father, we pray that whatever happens will be to your honor and glory. We pray that thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Amen.
We ask these things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Thank
Amen.
You. Thank you. Thank you, Father. Father,
God, I come to you with humble wisdom. Give you all the honor and glory, my God. Lord Jesus, bless you. Please forgive us for all our sins, Lord Jesus. Help those, Lord Jesus, that don't know you, Father God. We ask you to please help us to come together as a community, Lord Jesus. As you have instructed us to do your will, Lord Jesus, for each other, to serve each other. Lord Jesus, I ask you to please have mercy, Lord Jesus. On the broken hearts,
yes.
Jesus. Those, Father God, that feel like they've done so wrong, Lord Jesus, that you won't forgive them, Father God. But we ask you to please continue to give us the heart of compassion for each other, and to reach out to each other, lending a helping hand, Father God. And we praise and bless your holy name for what you have already done, Lord Jesus. We ask you to continue, Lord Jesus, to help us, Lord Jesus, to reach out and show each other the way.
Amen.
And that way is in you, Christ Jesus. Lord Jesus, we love you and we thank you, Father God. We give you all the honor and glory and praise in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father.
Amen.
art in heaven. Bless our church. Bless those that are here today, whether they come to serve you or whether they come to seek you.
Yeah.
Let this be a haven for them. Let us be able to reach out. Our church has always been loving and giving and supporting in every way we can. Not only bless us in numbers, but bless us in strength and wisdom. Bless us in that we can reach out to others in our community. Bring us the people we need to work for you, to help minister the children, to help minister the Sunday school, our small groups. Just give us the courage to step up, because it's so hard in today's society to sometimes let our Christian faith show.
Yes.
It's so easy on Sunday morning or Wednesday, but when we have to go out into the community, and sometimes we want our light to shine for people. And again, I say bless this day and lead us when we leave here, that your will be done throughout the week, throughout this year, and just lead us in the ways that we should go. Amen.
Thank you, dear Lord, for
amen.
This day you've given us.
Yes, amen.
We're so thankful for your love, that you love us, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for your many blessings. Bless this church. We love our church.
Amen.
We love these people.
Amen.
We love everyone, and we pray that your blessings be upon them and help our church to grow. Help us to do our part to love you and pray. And Lord, come and worship thee. Bless in the service, bless the singing and the playing, I pray. Amen.
Our Father, today, what a joy it is to be in your house. Hearts that are becoming one, willing to take a stand in this world that's full of darkness. Our prayer today is for our country, for the community, for this church, that the kingdom of God will be seen in each of our lives, that your light will penetrate the impending darkness. The news the other day, when a shot came from the space station, that there was a shot of the places where all the lights were in the United States on the East Coast, except for where the storm was. It was blackening out the light. Father, may the light of God through Jesus Christ, by the power of your Spirit, never be put out because of us. But may your light so shine through our lives that people will see our lives and give glory to our Father, which is in heaven. Thank you for the privilege of prayer. Thank you for the privilege of being in your house today. Thank you for the privilege of giving of tithes and offerings today. Thank you for those who are sick and hurting today, because their lives will be changed in a second because they put their trust in you. Father, we're praying for the month of October. You will create a time of miracles through the lives of everyone who walks, not only through the doors of this church, but everyone who goes out beyond this place, that you will use every heart that is hearing you today, no matter who they are, no matter how deep our faith may be, that those who will believe in the Lord our God, you mentioned in John chapter 14, verse 12, that those who will believe in you will do the same and even greater things than what you have done, if we will but believe in Jesus Christ. We believe today. We believe, and we're going to keep believing for your honor and for your glory, and that your kingdom will come. Lord, should you come today, may we all be ready. But Lord, if we are not, let us do it right now in your name. to make that plea upon our heart into your kingdom. Let us turn our lives over to you and believe in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you today. Can we just give God a hand clap? It's not me, it's him. Just give him glory today. Thank you, Father. Thank you so much. Gentlemen, come and you are guarded and prayed. God bless you today. Thank you so much.
Put my hope in your heart.
And one of those is when you have an opportunity to give God praise and background music. You can't find it anywhere on the planet. And you know it's a good one, but it's what makes you sound better, maybe. The devil fought me in a special way this week, but I give God glory. But I want to sing this song anyway, even though I don't have the background to it. So I hope it's okay. I hope you forgive me. If you know it, sing with me, that's fine. If you don't know it, that's okay too. I just pray that you'll hear the words and realize why it's so important to keep believing. Listen to these words. When troubles rise and catch you unaware, the day-to-day of living seems unfair. So you try again with your dreams and plans that have ended in defeat. And the happy thrills that once fulfilled now leave you incomplete. And you wonder where your life's gone wrong and why you can't find peace. Well, your hope's not gone, it's just been too long since you've had to believe. Keep believing in what you know is true. Keep believing. You know the Lord will see you through when troubles rise in your life. And you don't know what to do, you'll be fine if you just keep believing. You can take him at his word. He is faithful, kind, and true. Not a prayer will go unanswered. In his time, he'll see you through. Just keep believing, keep believing, keep believing. Praise God, amen.
Yeah.
out of whack. But God knows what He's doing. Amen? Thank you for being here today. Thank you for putting God first. Thank you for letting Him allow you and all of you to come and give glory to His name. As I mentioned earlier about the month of October, my prayer is that we'll have a month of miracles. Have you ever had a miracle happen in your life? Anybody, can you raise a hand? You ever had a miracle? Amen. You know what I'm talking about. If you haven't raised your hand yet, maybe today is your day of a miracle. I would say this to you. If you, those of you who are here today, and you've repented of your sin, you've confessed it to God, you've repented of it, and you put your trust in God through Jesus Christ, His Son, by the power of His Holy Spirit, you are a miracle. Sometimes we think it has to be, well, I got shot with a rifle and I didn't die. That's a miracle. I stepped out in the middle of the highway and a semi came and I went right through the truck. And I stood on the end of the, as the truck passed me, I didn't even, it's like I went right through the middle, right through the metal and the steel and everything and didn't even bother me. That would definitely be a miracle, amen? It really would be. Don't try it. Okay. The law of gravity tells me if I'm on a roof, like when I was a little kid, I'd put a towel around my t-shirt, I'd pin it on there, and I'd take this bath towel, and I'd pin it on because I was watching a lot of Superman back then, and I thought when I jumped out the second story window, I could fly. I realized gravity had another viewpoint. I fell and rolled, Dave, rolled. That's all I did. I just rolled down the hillside. When I was a kid, about the age of 7, I remember my parents came home and we were kind of tight on finances anyway. And I remember that they brought this big container. It was a big cardboard file and it had a record in it. It was a 33 and a third speed. I think that was the right number. You guys know what a record is? You know what a record is, amen? If you know what a record is, that means you're old. Amen, that's what that is. I like the little small ones, and you could, there's another story there. But I had this record, and my dad put it on the spindle, and he let it play, and I was listening about Peter Pan and Captain Hook, the Lost Boys. But they had this little jingle. It would always come back from time to time and have this swoosh and had this chime that would go through as well. And then you hear something and goes, you can fly, you can fly, you can fly, you can fly, you can fly. And I started thinking, I really could fly. And I thought that would have been an incredible thing of knowing. And that's why I did that silly thing and put that towel on my shirt. I thought, well, Superman can do it. I can surely do it as well. There's some things that I've learned a lot in life, and I've matured pretty quickly. I've done some really silly things. There's a four-letter word that's a theological word that some people don't want to use because it comes off really wrong, I know. But it's spelled D-U-M-M. Or you can put a B on the end of it, D-U-M-B. I've learned a lot of dumb things that way as well. The one thing I do know is that I put my hope and trust in God. The Bible tells us that miracles, there are miracles in the Bible that never happen. And if you need a miracle from God, are you believing in Him that He can still do a miracle in your life? Listen, it's not as hard as it sounds. It seems like there's only certain people that's allowed to have a miracle. Is that what it's all about? I thought the Bible said Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. I thought He was not a respecter of people. I believe that He doesn't judge. He says, don't judge. He tells us that in Matthew chapter 7, verse 1, doesn't He? And then in verse 2, He says, don't judge because the way you judge is how you will be judged. See, we miss that part. We just say, hey, you can't judge me. And then we just spout off to somebody else and start judging them. And we don't realize God holds us accountable for the way even our very character, our very attitude towards other people. The Bible says, if you want to flip with me to Matthew chapter 13, there's four verses I want to kind of look at just real quickly. And then there's some others as well I want to share with you. And in your worship folder, you can fill out these blanks if you like. But what I want to share with you today that you and I can keep believing in the Lord Jesus Christ no matter how difficult this world is. Earlier I heard in the prayer about how we need to pray for those who are elected above us. Sometimes you and I will spew out those character words and say, well, I don't agree with this and I don't agree with that. And we put so much weight upon the election. The election is not our issue. The issue is our heart towards everybody else. So many times we want to put out our standards that we're right and everyone else is wrong. I'm almost never right. My wife tells me so. Hey, in Matthew chapter 13, follow with me if you would. Look at verse 54 through 58. It says this. Coming to his hometown, Jesus began teaching the people in their synagogue, and they were amazed. And they said these things. Where did this man get this wisdom and these miraculous powers, they asked. Isn't this the carpenter's son? Isn't his mother's name Mary? And aren't the brothers James, his brother's names James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas? Aren't all his sisters with us? Where did this man get these things? Or in the message it says, who does he think he is? I kind of like that rendering. And in verse 57 he says, and they took offense at Jesus. But Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor except in his own town and in his own home. And Jesus, the Bible says, did not do many miracles there because of their lack of faith. How much faith do you and I need to have? I remember Jesus one time telling a person, he says, if you have a mountain standing in front of you, if you take a mustard seed, and have a grain of faith the size of a mustard seed, you can say to that mountain, be cast into the sea, and it'll be done. Do you remember that? You remember where he said that? So how big does our faith have to be? Amen? How much do we have to have? I mean, there's some religious cultures that believe unless you crawl on your hands and knees for, say, 20 miles to prove your unworthiness, that you'll not get the miracle or the blessing that you're looking for. Some say you have to cry out and pray a certain type of prayer every time just to have heaven hear your heart. Jesus said it doesn't take much. It's like the old missionary song that says, little is much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There is a crown and you can win it. I'm wondering, I'm playing with a finger here thinking you might sing that. If you go
in Jesus' name.
I'm sorry, in David's name, your name? If we go in Jesus' name, amen? We go in Jesus' name. There's not much that you have to do. Romans chapter said, if you will believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead and confess it with your mouth, you will be saved. And then he says in verse 11, chapter 10, verse 11, he says, and anyone who puts their trust in Jesus will, underlining, never be put to shame. Anybody okay with that? Maybe you've been embarrassed because you served Jesus. Maybe people have put you down because you served Jesus. Maybe people have cursed you and said all kinds of manner of evil against you because of Jesus. But Jesus reminded his disciples there in Matthew chapter 5, he says, when people say all manner of evil against you, don't take it personal or personally. Because it's not you they're upset with. They're upset with Jesus, okay? But he still wants us to serve him. Why do miracles happen when they happen? Because somebody is trusting in the Lord their God. The mom who's sat upon and the dad who's been on the foot of the bed praying that their child would just make it through the night. And somehow they awaken and they hear a hand of what used to be paralyzed. It starts scratching the sheet and it starts trembling and jumping like a heartbeat. And they start realizing there's something happening here. There's a miracle starting to occur. Wow, this is incredible. Then they cry out, oh God, thank you for helping my child. Thank you so much. And so many times I think God wants to give us a miracle, but we're so wrapped up in ourselves, we don't even acknowledge that He is the one who's in charge. Amen. He's wanting to give us miracles. He's wanting to show them right in front of us. But sometimes we're putting our faith in everybody else. Thank God for the doctors and the medical people. We pray for them. Dr. King, we pray for you, brother. And all the staff and people you have, and you go on your mission trips as well, and others of you who are in the healthcare industry, we thank God for you. We thank God for our teachers and educators and business people. We thank God for you. God is creating miracles and through so many of your lives, putting God first. He will use you, and His kingdom will never end because you have allowed Him to work through your life. In Matthew 23, verse 37, Jesus says, "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those who sent to you, how often I have longed to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing." God is willing. Are you? God wants to help you. Are you willing? God is just waiting on you and me to surrender down to His will. Are you and I willing to surrender fully to His will? Realize this. Unbelief does not happen. More miracles do not happen because of unbelief. Unbelief is what stops the miracles of God. There are 36 miracles recorded in the Gospels alone. 26 Jesus does with other people, and 10 He does in kind of a solo type fashion. But there's at least 36 that I have found in the Gospels alone. There's other miracles in the Bible, but I'm talking about Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. It's a little bit like the cartoon I saw the other day. Someone posted it, I think it was on Facebook. They said Matthew is acting up, but Mark, Luke, and John are still doing a lot better today. They're a lot nicer today. But Matthew, that was my nephew's name over here, Matt, over here. He's from Jacksonville, and he's been exemplary this past weekend. Amen. He's doing so well. I'll call and tell your mama. This is Becky's son, my sister Becky's son. Okay. Of these 36 miracles that's recorded in the Gospels, the miracles were to teach, to reveal, and to demonstrate the deity of Jesus Christ. But there's so many more that He wanted to share and to do, but they were not willing to have them. The Bible lets us know of these 36, they were there on purpose. They were recorded with a purpose. But few selected miracles were not recorded. In John chapter 20, verse 30 and 31, it says this, "And many other signs Jesus did in the presence of His disciples, which were not written in this book," in John's Gospel, "but these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God." He then goes on and says in John 21, verse 25, "Jesus did many other things as well. If every one of them were written down, I suppose that even the whole world would not be able to have enough room for all the books that would have been written." Jesus did a lot of powerful things, but this is all that we have. This is all that we know. I like the story about the atheist one day. He got a little smart aleck with Jesus' disciples and says these words. He said, "Hey, where is he? Where is that son of a carpenter?" And the disciples looked back with love in their heart. They said, "He's out building wooden caskets for you and your friends." Amen. You missed that one completely. That was supposed to be a joke, and I should have said a little different, maybe. He was trying to put them down, and they simply said, "He's out building wooden caskets. You're about ready to die. Unless you believe in Jesus, you're going to die." There are needs here today that only the miraculous power of God can meet. There are needs in this sanctuary today that need the fresh touch of God Almighty. And unless you and I are willing to allow Him to work within our life, you will not receive your miracle. No matter how much Jesus wants to give it to you, you will not receive it unless you are willing to let Him come in. He's knocking, the Bible says. He says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock," Revelation 3:20. "And if anyone would hear my voice and would open the door, I will come in and eat with them," or have fellowship with them, "and they will eat with me." We will have this relationship, this friendship, this fellowship. We will have this connection. when we have this bonding that will happen. But the whole key, do you hear it? Is that if anyone who will, is that you today? Have you opened the door? Is he in your heart? Is he in your life? I pray that he is, because he wants to create a miracle in your life. And just because he creates one miracle doesn't mean he doesn't want to do a second miracle. Today, you and I think, well, I haven't even gotten my miracle yet, so I must be completely off the chart. Honey, he's waiting on you right now, right where you're seated at in the sanctuary. He's wanting you to realize you are a miracle waiting to occur, to happen. Well, I'm listening. I haven't heard what he has to say yet. Well, are you willing to do what he wants you to do? It's so easy to tell other people what to do, isn't it? You know? Don't do this. Pick this up. Take care of that. Do this or else. But sometimes, that great theologian that I remember hearing him say this maybe almost 40 years ago, I don't know if he's a theologian nowadays, be good if he was. I think he's incarcerated, actually. But he said, Bill Cosby said, the proof is in the pudding. People see from the lifestyle that you live of who directs your life. He's saying the person that you believe in the most is what comes out of your life. It's like when the toothpaste in your heart, so to speak, when your lives are squeezed, as Romans 12:1 says, it says, don't be squeezed into the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. It's like our lives, our heart, is like a tube of toothpaste, and when it's squeezed, what's on the inside is what's coming out. What comes out in your life? What do people see when you're squeezed? When the pressures of life are happening, do you realize God is ready to create a miracle to even splash onto somebody else? Because of the actions or the reactions from your life. There are needs here today that only the miraculous power of God can touch. There's a passage where it says in Luke chapter 4, and Jesus has gone back to his home, it says in verse 16, in Luke chapter 4, says he went to Nazareth. He went home where he had been brought up. And on the Sabbath day, he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. And he unrolled it, and he found the place where it is written, the Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom to the prisoners, recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. You ever wonder what the Lord's favor is? You ever wondered? The favor of God, there are times, imagine it's Christmas holidays. They'll be here in just a few weeks, it seems like. Where has those January resolutions gone? Amen. It's October the 9th, believe it or not. You're going somewhere to shop for a present for someone. And you're driving in and out of the mall. And you're looking the place wherever you're going to go find some gift you want to give to someone because you love them. And you want to express your love in just a small, tangible way. I don't know. It's not in the gift. It's from the heart that you give it from is what people really are blessed by. Thank you for the gift, whatever that might be. But you're driving in and up and down the rows and people are waiting. And you're getting frustrated. Or you can actually say, Lord, thank you. Thank you for this day. Thank you, I have the privilege of going through all this traffic. Yeah, right, I'm sure you and I are going to probably say that, right? Thank you, Lord, for not in a traffic jam in the parking lot. But why not the next time simply say, oh, Lord, thank you for all these people that you died for. And I pray, Lord, if you want me to have a parking space near the front entry of the door of the store because I have a bad knee and I don't have to walk as far and I don't have a handicap sticker, Lord, if you want, it's okay with me if you like to open up a slot. If not, Lord, I will park wherever you open up the next slot. All of a sudden, you're still tracking, and you're thinking, maybe the Lord's not hearing me. Maybe I need to go a little louder. Lord's got a good hearing. He doesn't need to hear a shouting. And all of a sudden, you just say, Lord, I thank you. I just thank you for that spot you're opening up. Now, maybe it just doesn't happen all the time for you, but it's happened for me. I don't think I have any more of the Lord's favor than you have. I think, in fact, you may have more than I do. But one day I was doing this, and I said, Lord, thank you for that spot, wherever it may be. I give you glory for it. That's all I said. And I pulled right up, and all of a sudden, I'm at the end of the row, and there's a car in front of me. And I see down at the very end, the first slot, there's a car with the reverse lights on. And it's backing up, and I said, oh, thank you, Lord. The car in front of me is going to get this spot. I know this sounds silly. But the Lord's favor worked it out this way. Someone else, just before that car got up there, came out, and that man went into that slot and left that other one open for me, and I got to park at the front entry door. That's like the favor of God. He's wanting you to have His favor. He's wanting to bless you. He's wanting to encourage you this very day. But within the very life of where Jesus was raised, there were people who were demon-possessed. They needed the favor of God. There are people who are depressed. They needed the favor of God. There are people who are simply unburied dead, that the Bible would say. Not zombies, but people who simply had no care in their world, their lives. They felt like they didn't matter to anybody. They were just living out their time until they die. And when they die, they believed they're just dead. They're done in this life. God has a purpose for every human being that is breathing His great air for our lives. Do you believe that today? And He wants to make a miracle out of your life as well. But Jesus cannot do the miracles if the people, like in Nazareth, the Bible says, He could not do the miracles in Nazareth other than maybe touching a few people and helping them from a cold or some minor type thing because they didn't want to believe. There's a passage over in Matthew chapter 8, verse about 34, that when Jesus came into the region of Galilee, they told Jesus these words, "Leave us, Jesus. Leave us alone. Go away from us." It's got to be the most saddest prayer I've ever heard. A comment that people had the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords right in their very presence, and they're begging Him to leave their city, their region. I'm wondering if that hasn't happened in the United States of America. I'm wondering if it hasn't happened within the state of Florida. In Leon County, Tallahassee. I'm praying it hasn't happened in First Church of the Nazarene. Lord, leave us alone. You're making me feel guilty. I don't like to feel guilty. The power of the Holy Spirit is set for two purposes. He is to convict us of our sin and to convince us to put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ alone. Amen? So when you're getting the pressure of the Holy Spirit upon you about the sin in your life, don't shut it down. Embrace it. Because if God surely didn't care about you, He definitely would not even speak to you, and He would never. You must be really looking serious because your face is looking really serious. There's not a lot of smiles out there. But thank you for your listening. I appreciate that very much. Because I'm just wrapping this up. There will possibly be unopened gifts here today. People here who God is wanting to give you the gift of His salvation, His promise, His miraculous touch this very day. Will He find unopened gifts here this day? Back about May of 2001, it was a cool morning, and something terrible happened at about 4:15 a.m. that morning. There was a loud thud on our house. It sounded like a bomb had gone off in the neighborhood. I went out the front door, I looked up in the sky, I thought, what in the world was that? And the sky was dark, 4:15 a.m. in Macon, Georgia. The darkness was there, the stars were standing in the sky, and there was no storm. I didn't hear any sirens. I didn't hear any, did I say sirens? I've been living in Florida, North Florida for a while. I haven't heard any sirens. There's no one coming for our aid. And I thought, what in the world, what is that sound? So I went back inside the house, and Brad comes running down the hallway. He's a teenager. He's about 14 years of age, 15. Dad, come quick. So, beelining down the hallway. Nita's behind me. We're going down the hallway in the back of the house. Old house built in the 1900s, huge 12-foot ceilings. Went to the very back. It looked like it was about 50 yards to go from the front door to the back door. It was a long hallway. We got back there, and he opened up the door. He said, "Look." I said, "What is it?" Against our exterior storm screen door was a giant tree pressed against the door. And in the bathroom, in the back of the house, the restroom, there was a branch that come all the way through the upside of the ceiling of the bathroom, shattered the toilet and the tub, and there were fragments broken everywhere. It was just crazy. And then I go in and check on Jeff, and he's sound asleep. He did that in college. Good to see you, Spence. Welcome home. Macy, good to see you. Hope your brother's been nice to you at Trevecca. Amen. I know you're not sitting beside each other this morning, though. Thank you, Dad, for being picking. They're home from college, so we're glad they're here. But Jeff is just out. And I shook him. I said, "Jeff, are you okay?" What, me? Mom? "No, this is your father with a high voice." "Huh? Oh, what? What is it?" I said, "Get up. Something's happened. Something hit the house, and it's a big tree." We didn't know until the next day the miracle that God spared us from, and Jeff as well. This is the window. Imagine the end of this podium where the wall is, the screen, and the window. And Jeff was like laying in his bed here, right beside the wall of the house, right into the ground. We had some people come and cut the wood and everything up, get it off the house. It split the house down the very top center of it. And in the ground, there was a piece of wood that was cut off of the ground. And I grabbed it, and I pulled it up, and I pulled. It was over four, almost 5 feet in length. I pulled it up out of the ground. It was a large cone shape of a branch that speared. Now, just think with me. Now I know it's the wrong imagination, and it's our story. I don't know. It's just something I'm telling you. And I'm not trying to be sensationalist at this, but tell me what would happen if that tree coughed just a little bit and spun just a little bit more. It could have very well speared our son at that time and would have taken his very life because of the window. The wood was right in front of his window, right in the center part of that. And if it were coughed just a little, it would have gone right into the window, I believe. He would have never had a chance. It would have killed him on the spot. I would call that a miracle of God. You think God's favor, his miracle, protected Jeff? I do. Well, why did he do that to Jeff? I don't know, but I'm thankful that he did. Why is it that we tithe? We tithe not to get from God. We tithe because he asked us to do that. We put him first. We trust in him. There are times where we have given to where we had nothing left, but we trusted God because we believed in our heart it's better to give than it's what we needed to honor him for. But we have never struggled, friends. We have never struggled by putting God first. And I believe that's why he protected our son, right? That day, he protected him because he's in the faithfulness. Well, pastor, you don't understand. I'm faithful to God. I'm faithful in all these areas too. But we just had this trauma in our life. I'm sorry. I don't know what happens for some and not for others. He says it rains on the just and the unjust. Let me say this in the last word, I promise. Storms may come your way, but God is faithful. And no matter how bad the defeat is, that it seems inevitable that it's coming your way, it's not over till God says it's over. And no matter what storm you are facing this very time in your life, God has put a miracle right in front of you. Not this one, but the very cross of Jesus Christ today. He's wanting to do something powerful within each of our lives. What are you willing to allow him to do in your life today? What do you need God to do in your life? The opening story I told you about Peter Pan, the thing I didn't tell you was this. Part of the reason why he could fly is because he had to find his happy thoughts. You remember that story? Now I know it's a kid's story, it's a fictional story, but I guess I'm kind of asking you and me the same question today. What is your happy thought? Is your children? Is it your job? Is it your home? Is it your car? Is it the clothing that you wear? I believe Jesus Christ is my happy thought. I can use it that way, and not using it in the wrong way. Jesus Christ is not fictional. He's not Peter Pan. He is the Son of God. He is God. The Bible declares He sits at the right hand of God the Father, interceding for you. And I'd like to invite you just to stand. We don't have any music playing. I just want you in the quietness of the hour, stand together with me. I want you to bow your head. I want you to think of this question again. I ask, what do you need God to do in your life today? Amen. Bow your head. Close your eyes. Ask Him, oh Lord, what is it in my life that you don't have? And allow me today to have the courage to give it to you. Oh Lord, thank you for everyone who's here this day. Thank you for everyone who's in your divine presence. They're not here by accident. They're here by divine appointment. And I give you praise for that. Lord, this day there's someone here who needs to say, oh Lord, come into my life. Change my life. Lord, let it be today. Create a miracle in me. I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, I'm asking everyone not to look. Do you believe Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God? With every head bowed, every eye closed. If you believe that, could you raise your hand? I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. I believe that. If you believe that, raise your hand and put it down real quickly. Amen. 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 Lord, you've seen so many hands, and the hands that weren't raised, maybe they didn't understand the question. But pretty much hands went up all over this entire house today, except for a few. Father, we pray today that you will do your work and create that miracle in each and every life. Lord, we love you and thank you for your promises that you want to set us free. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise God. He's so good. God bless you today. Thank you for being in this house this day. You're dismissed. If you want to see someone about the photos, see Wanda or whoever's out front today. Thank you.
It's trying to get done, but they got me up way late. I'm supposed to get up early, so we can get out early. Thank you. Had a fun time. Hope it communicated okay. I know one thing, I sure sweat a lot. I have to go home and change this, come back to the picture table. Anita has us down for 120, 130. Okay, let's go over there, let's find her. And if you don't mind making this, things are hers, and I'm going to go to Mexico. That's okay. That's okay. Thank you. That's okay.
No.
The second song.
I didn't know you had to be
I'm glad you're here.
by a car.
Ready to go. You ready?